A, asking. S, seeking. K, knocking. So what does it all boil down to? Ask. You receive not because you ask not. Okay? Oh, yeah. And actually, the other reference that I had made concerning the unjust judge is in Luke chapter 18. And to my knowledge, this is the only gospel that relates this parable. Okay? And all that we've been talking about for the last several minutes is referring to Luke being the gospel of prayer. There are just so many instances of prayer. In Luke 18, and he spake a parable unto them to this end, that men ought always to pray and not to faint, saying, there was in a city a judge which feared not God, neither regarded man. And there was a widow in that city, and she came unto him, saying, avenge me of mine adversary. And he would not for a while, but afterward he said within himself, though I fear not God, nor regard man, yet, because this widow troubleth me, I will avenge her, lest by her continual coming she weary me. So he's basically saying is, it looks pretty obvious that she's just going to keep coming back, coming back, coming back. So I think what I'll do is go ahead and grant her petition. And the Lord said, hear what the unjust judge saith. And shall not God avenge his own elect, which cried day and night unto him, though he bear long with him? I tell you that he will avenge them speedily. Nevertheless, when the Son of Man cometh, shall he find faith on the earth? Let me make just a further comment here. Now, it's very obvious what this parable is speaking about and what the previous parable in chapter 11 is speaking about is importunity, meaning that you keep asking. You keep asking. Now, Jesus is saying that if you cry unto God day and night, that he will avenge you speedily. In other words, just based on the fact that you keep asking. Now, that's in contradiction to a lot of people's faith statement that says, you only ask one time. I understand that principle, okay? You only ask one time because if you ask more than once, all your previous times were not in faith. You understand the point? In other words, if you have faith in your first prayer, you don't have to pray again. Right? And so that's the reason why that even though Jesus says here that the Heavenly Father would avenge you speedily, he says, nevertheless, when the Son of Man cometh, shall he find faith on the earth? So the higher order is what? That he finds faith. What he's really saying here is that if you continually ask, you may have been asking in unbelief, but I believe at some point in time, God is going to see your heart and he's going to move in your behalf. I know that there's so many principles that we have misunderstood, misinterpreted. I made this statement, and I will make a statement again, and I will still stand by this statement, that God does not just automatically respond because you have a need. Which means that he does respond to either prayer, your asking, your exercising faith. Now, if God just automatically responded because there was a need, there'd never be a need. If God responded because there are starving kids in Africa, there'd never be a starving kid in Africa. Right? Okay? So that would simply indicate to me that just because you have a need doesn't move the heart of God. Even though Jesus said, you know, don't worry about tomorrow. Consider the lily. Consider the sparrow of the air. You know, God takes care of them. How much more will he take care of us? Now, there he is talking about not fretting, not worrying about tomorrow. But on the other hand, there is an exercise on our part of accepting what Jesus said and believing that. And that faith is what activates God in clothing us even more beautiful than the lily and taking care of us more meticulously than he would the birds of the air. Do you understand the point I'm making here? The point I'm making is that God does not just automatically respond because there's a need. Either have to ask or believe or just stand on the word of God. You know, there are times that we as believers, you know, maybe things are not going the way that we think we ought, but there's a faith and a confidence that we have that God's going to take care of everything, you know. So what really activates God is faith. And then, of course, we know that, you know, God is God. As Jackie Beavers used to say, God's God all by himself. In other words, he's God, whether we recognize him or not, and he doesn't need our help to make him God. He's God. He's sovereign. And, you know, so there are times that God's going to move sovereignly. In other words, it's not that the only time God moves is when you ask, because there are many times God moves when you don't ask. But we have the confidence to believe that when we do ask, and there are conditions there because the scripture says that you ask or you receive not because you ask not. You ask and you don't receive because you ask amiss. In other words, there are times when you ask amiss, you may not get, by the grace of God, you may not get what you're asking for because sometimes, as Garth Brooks says, thank God for unanswered prayers. Now, some of you may not identify with that song, and maybe some of you never heard that song, but it basically is that, you know, he had this sweetheart in high school, fell in love with her, and he apparently had prayed, you know, oh God, you know, give her to me, you know, I want her, you know, this is what I want. And later in life, and that was denied him, and later in life, he said, thank God you didn't answer my prayer. You know, so by the mercy of God, there are times our prayers may not be answered. You know, because the grace of God, and again, you know, it becomes a heart issue. It becomes an issue, I believe, God knowing our heart. Now, you can say whatever you want to say. Confession is important. But sometimes we may not say exactly the right thing according to someone's formula. You know, people say, well, if you say it just right. Sometimes you may make a mess out of how you say it, but God knows your heart, right? I mean, you know, he knows your heart, and so it's faith that God is looking for. So again, here in chapter 18, he is saying that God will avenge us when we cry out to him day and night. But the question is, the bigger question is, will there not be faith? Which says that if there's faith, you can ask. And when you have this is the way I try to function. And hey, I'm flesh, you're flesh. There have been times I've felt like a superman in faith, and there have been times I didn't feel so super, you know. God understands that too, you know. Thank God for his grace. But, you know, if we learn how to trust God, just learn to trust him, to know that he's going to take care of us, to know that everything's going to work out all right. It hadn't been too long ago, I went through some very strong emotions, you know, about some things. And I have to admit, you know, when you go through some of those times, you just have to simply say, God, I don't know how you're going to do it. And I tell you, I'm just like a lot of other folks. Many times I wondered, you know, how far God was away, you know.
but always knowing He's there. So we have this quiet assurance, we have this confidence that God is there. And when you have that confidence, when you have that trust, you ask in faith, and then you just simply wait for the answer, right? You see the point that Jesus made here? He said, God will move if you ask more than once. But the higher order is, will He find faith? God responds to faith. But that is not the only way God responds. Faith teachers teach, you know, that it's almost like you manipulate God with your faith. In other words, God's not going to move if you don't have faith, and He will move when you do have faith. And it's like, you know, that whatever you say, that's why it's just like God's going to be at your beck and cry. The bottom line is, God is God. God is sovereign. He doesn't have to respond to anything. I mean, but thank God He does. Okay, so I just gave you a couple. I took a lot of time there. Like I said, we're going to lay a good foundation here. We're going to have plenty of time to get into the acts of Scripture, because I'm going to spend less time on the repetition of some of the things that we've already covered in the other Gospels. Okay, so one defining characteristic of Luke as a gospel is, it's a gospel of prayer. A second characteristic that I think that would be defining of Luke as a gospel is that Luke has been called the gospel of women. A gospel of women. Do you understand that even we as believers, we as born again believers, liberated, enlightened believers, still, either through ignorance or tradition or whatever, are still blinded with prejudices? And when I speak about prejudices, I'm not necessarily talking about race, which of course that's a big, but there are also gender prejudices. And oftentimes well-meaning, we talk about, the man being the head, and the next step, if we're not careful, is like we project a spirit of superiority. And it's not the matter of superiority. It's not the matter of one being superior over another. There are only two classes of people as far as God's concerned. That's either you're a believer or you're an unbeliever. You can say it this way. You're of the light or you're not of the light. See, it's not the matter of male, female. It's not the matter of black, white, Jew, Gentile, Greek, barbarian, right? In Christ Jesus, there are no distinctions there. I'm making that point to say this. Matthew was a good Jew. Even though he was a believer, even though he was a disciple. I'm not going to take too much liberty here, and I'm not going to project too much. I'm just going to simply say Luke gave far more respect to women than any of the other writers. And I'm just using Matthew as an example because it was a strong, strong Jewish tradition that women were really little more than nothing. You follow me? That they were considered very low on the totem pole. And a lot of that philosophy, and you got to be careful here, but a lot of that bleeds through even in some of the writings of the New Testament. Now, I want you to understand very clearly what I'm saying here. I am not discrediting the Scripture, but I will promise you that there were things that were written in the epistles, even the Pauline epistles, that seemed to indicate a lesser role for women than God had intended. But Paul himself is the one who made the statement that in Christ there's no distinction, right? You follow? I mean, you know, Paul spoke about things like, you know, let not a woman use authority over a man. And, you know, the truth is, it's not the matter of us usurping authority over anybody. Usurping just simply refers to taking authority that doesn't belong to you. And sometimes, well, first of all, the devil is the biggest usurper of authority there is. I mean, he's the one who's guilty of taking authority where he doesn't have authority. Now, I just simply make this statement, then I move on. That much that is written in the New Testament, especially as it deals with the man-woman issue, is a reflection of a cultural setting. This was written in light of a particular culture that existed. So you say, well, you know, isn't the Word of God relevant? Absolutely. But where the true relevance comes is in understanding the principle that is communicated. You see, there were some cultural statements that were made, but the principle was this, that in Christ there is no distinction. That is the principle, which means that that principle will hold true in any culture. A true principle is true. It ministers truth regardless of time frames, regardless of geography. Principles transcend time, places. You understand what I'm saying? In other words, the principle of the Word of God is going to work in one culture just as well as it will in another culture. Okay, again here, all I'm doing is to establish the fact. Luke was not bound by the traditions of the Jews. And I say that, and yet even in the ancient world, I'm trying to think who probably had less consideration for women than the other. I think it maybe the Romans had less consideration for women than the Greek did. Because, you know, you had your Roman gods, did you not? And you had your Greek goddesses? Mm-hmm. Am I right on that? Or I didn't get it reversed, did I? Luke, I mean, the Greek, I never even thought in terms of this. But I'm believing that even the Greek had a little bit more respect for women than the Romans did. I mean, the Romans' opinion of women was probably lower than the opinion of the Jews. But let me give you some more specifics here concerning how that Luke is called the Gospel of Women. Be a good test question here. I could ask you, give me some examples of Luke's emphasis or his attention that he gives to women. Well, the birth narrative of Jesus is told from Mary's point of view. Okay? The actual story, the narrative of the birth of Jesus is told through the eyes of Mary herself, right? It is in Luke that we read about Elizabeth, Anna, the widow of Nain, of the woman who anointed Jesus' feet in the house of Simon the Pharisee. It is Luke who makes most vivid the pictures of Martha and Mary, Mary Magdalene. And one of the explanations, I said that it would be very easily for you, even though you would be a believer, it would still be easy for you to be influenced by your upbringing, by tradition. And aren't we all grateful that God is bringing enlightenment, that God is opening our eyes to things that we have been blinded to? Well, you know, hey, 150 years ago, there were sincere people, sincere Christians, who thought slavery was okay. Now, that didn't make it okay, and I'm not justifying that in any way. I guess the point I'm making is that the church finally woke up. But can I tell you, the church hasn't awakened near as much as the general culture or the community has? You ever thought about it? The most segregated place on between 11 and 12 o'clock is in the church on Sunday morning. Sunday morning is the most segregated institution in the United States of America. Think about it. There's more integration on the job, right? Integration in the schools. But what about the churches? Something doesn't add up, right? Something does not add up. So here we're saying, well, you know, you got to make it work on the job. You got to make it work in the community. You got to make it work in the schools, the workplace. How about making it work in church? I mean, that'd be a good place to start. That if we're the salt of the earth and if we're the light of the world, we ought to be the ones who are setting the trend. We ought to be the ones who are breaking down the barriers. Okay? So, one of the barriers that was broken down is that Luke certainly gave proper emphasis to women. And one of the reasons it's thought, besides, you know, the grace of God and, you know, the fact that, you know, God opened every one of our eyes to things that we were blinded to, besides the fact that there could very likely have been a spiritual awakening inside of Luke that caused him to give this proper emphasis, from a purely natural point of view, remember, Luke was the only non-Jew who wrote a book in the New Testament. Okay? It is thought that Luke was from Macedonia, of course, which was a Gentile province, where women held a little bit higher position. They had a little bit more of an emancipated position than almost anywhere else in the ancient world. So again, Luke might have been just functioning purely from as a product of his own culture. We are still products of our culture. We're still products of our upbringing. And that is one of the things that every one of us have to break through. We have to break through not only cultural barriers, we have to break through religious barriers. A third defining characteristic of Luke as a gospel is that Luke has been also referred to as a gospel of praise. Now, we've already said it's a gospel of prayer. Now, I find all this very fascinating. You know, just in your casual reading of the New Testament, you're probably not even going to discover many of these things until it's pointed out to you. And I'm not, you know, presenting myself as being super smart that I found out all of these things on my own, but I do read, I do study, you know. I still consider myself a student. In Luke, the phrase, praising God, occurs more often than in all of the rest of the New Testament put together. Now, to me, that's a fascinating fact. The phrase, praising God, occurs more often in the book of Luke than it does in all the rest of the New Testament put together. Isn't that interesting? Mm-hmm. So we could say that one of the defining characteristics of Luke as a gospel is it's a gospel of praise. It's a gospel of prayer. It's a gospel of women. It's a gospel of praise. Praise reaches its peak in three great hymns that the church has sung throughout all generations.
One is what is called the Magnificat. This is Mary's song. This is in Luke 1, 46 through 55. And the Benedictus, which is Luke 1, 68, and I don't even recall what that is. If you're ignorant of something, find out. Okay, all right. So the Benedictus is actually what Zacharias prophesied after his tongue was loosed. Blessed be the Lord God of Israel, for he hath visited and redeemed his people, and hath raised up an horn of salvation for us in the house of his servant David, as he spake by the mouth of his holy prophets, which have been since the world began, that we should be saved from our enemies and from the hand of all that hate us, to perform the mercy promised our fathers, and to remember his holy covenant, the oath which he sware to our father Abraham, that he would grant unto us, that we being delivered out of the hand of our enemies might serve him with fear, in holiness and righteousness before him all the days of our life. And thou, child, shalt be called the prophet of the highest. Now keep in mind, this is really one of the classic hymns of the church throughout centuries. And this is a prophecy. Thou, child, shalt be called the prophet of the highest, for thou shalt go before the face of the Lord to prepare his ways, to give knowledge of salvation unto his people by the remission of their sins through the tender mercy of our God, whereby the day spring from on high hath visited us, to give light to them that sit in darkness and in the shadow of death, to guide our feet into the way of peace. And as the child grew, he waxed strong in spirit and was in the desert till the day of his showing unto Israel. So this is a beautiful prophecy that has become a hymn of the church that is speaking about John the Baptist. And then the third is what is called the Nunc Dimittis. This is in chapter 2, 29 through 32. So let's see what that is. Okay, this is the prayer that Simeon prayed, and we'll talk more about Simeon in the next lesson or two, probably next week. But this is the prayer that Simeon offered up to the Lord that has become a great hymn of the church. Lord, now lettest thou thy servant depart in peace according to thy word, for mine eyes have seen thy salvation, which thou hast prepared before the face of all people, a light to lighten the Gentiles and the glory of thy people Israel. And so that is what is referred to as the Nunc Dimittis. Then fourth and finally, concerning the characteristics of Luke as a gospel, is that of all of the Gospels, Luke is probably considered to be the most universal. And of course, that simply means that Luke recognized that Jesus was for all men, for the whole world. Jesus was the lamb slain for the whole world. Luke, more so than any of the other writers, has broken down barriers, and he has presented Jesus for all people without distinction. The kingdom of heaven is not shut up to the Samaritans. Luke alone, now again, you know, we're looking for these things that distinguishes one gospel from another. Only Luke tells the parable of the Good Samaritan. Of course, everybody's familiar with that. You have your religious leaders who just walk right on by. But it was a Samaritan who was considered really scum. The Samaritan to the Jews was no more than a dog. But it was the Samaritan that Luke refers to as being the one who extended help
to the man who had been beaten and left for dead, right? Only Luke tells the story of the Good Samaritan. And the one leper who came back and who was grateful to Jesus was a Samaritan. This was a Samaritan. So these are just a couple of incidents here to show us that Luke takes special effort to bring out the significance of those who were not Jews, which again speaks of the universality. Luke shows Jesus speaking with approval of Gentiles whom an Orthodox Jew would not have even considered, would not have even given them the time of day. In fact, they would have considered them as being unclean. But Luke speaks about them giving approval to Jesus. And, you know, Jews would say, yeah, what does that mean? I mean, you know, so you have the approval of a dog. But Luke takes the time to record that. Luke shows Jesus citing the widow of Zarephath and Naaman the Syrian as shining examples. And those are Gentiles. The Roman centurion, who was a Gentile, is praised for his greatness of faith. And Luke says in chapter 13, verse 29, people will come from the east and west, from the north and south, and will eat in the kingdom of God. Now, those are four characteristics, and I'll go over them very quickly again, that define Luke as a gospel. The first was what? What was the first?
It's a gospel of good news.
Gospel of prayer. Right? Was that the first one?
Yes.
You got that?
Okay. You said gospel of prayer.
The gospel of prayer. What was the second one?
Gospel of women.
Gospel of women. What was the third?
Gospel of praise.
Gospel of praise. The fourth?
And considered the most universal.
Yeah. Universal. Gospel. Okay. Another thing that I think that we could say about Luke, and again, I think this would be in the character of Luke as being a presenter of Jesus for all people. Luke is probably, more so than any of the other gospel writers, supremely interested in the poor. Now, I'm going to give you an example here, which is one of the reasons why that we can probably make this statement. And I do you understand that even when we talk about maybe one being a little bit more sensitive in certain areas, it's not saying anything to discredit any of the others. And so here we are, we're wondering, you know, why do you have four Gospels? Many of them tell the same story. Again, they're intended for different population, different audiences. And if you can understand the culture to whom they are speaking, it can probably give you more understanding of what is sought to be communicated. But, of course, Luke speaks in Luke 4:18. He talks about the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, you know, because he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. Now, in that same scripture, it says he's anointed me, you know, set at liberty those that are bound, to open the prison doors, to heal those who are blind. And so, if preaching the gospel to the poor is including all of that, I would say, in other words, the gospel was preached so the blind would be blind no longer, right? So the deaf would be deaf no longer. And so if you take that, extend that on out, the gospel preached to the poor so that they'd be poor no longer. Okay? Now, that's one way we can look at it. But there's also another way of looking at it, and it is that, yes, the literal poor, that they were important enough. Nobody else may not have considered them important, but they were important enough that they had the gospel presented to them. In fact, it was probably the poor, the no-name, the multitudes who were the followers of Jesus. You had some of the noblemen, you had some of the elite, some of the upper crust, but the majority of those that followed Jesus were just the poor, humble people, the common people, the multitudes. Luke has been called the gospel of the underdog. Luke, above all, shows Jesus as the friend of outcasts and sinners. He talks about Zacchaeus, the despised tax gatherer. He makes a reference to the penitent thief who was an underdog. And here's another story that's not written in any other gospel, and that's the story of the prodigal son. So Luke presents the immortal story of the prodigal son and the loving father. Again, in Matthew, Jesus instructs his disciples to not go to the Samaritan or the Gentiles, but Luke omits any of those distinctions at all, altogether. So I guess we could say Luke really saw no limit to the love of God. Well, that's really about all the time that we have. That's all the time we're going to take, but that's really about all the time that we have. We're running out of time. So let's stop there for tonight. And next week, we're going to go